CNN. Breaking news.
Kelly told staffers this morning, and yes, you're right, he is the same John Kelly whose job itself has reportedly been in jeopardy. And yes, he was talking in part about National Security Advisor H.R. McMaster, whose job may already be gone. And yes, in addition to General McMaster, at least four cabinet secretaries were reportedly in the presidential doghouse. Four, at least. And yes, sources close to the president or familiar with his thinking have been warning all week that a big shakeup could be coming. Reports are the president is actually enjoying the process, which is probably more than H.R. McMaster can say, or Jeff Sessions, David Shulkin, or Ben Carson. It's unlikely Rex Tillerson enjoyed it much. He was, of course, fired this week after months of tortured speculation and reporting. Reporting, by the way, the president called fake news, tweeting, quote, "The media has been speculating that I fired Rex Tillerson or that he would be leaving soon. Fake news. He's not leaving, and while we disagree on certain subjects, I call the final shots. We work well together, and America is highly respected again." That tweet was around 15 weeks ago. And yes, there really is a tweet for everything. The sheer number of high-profile departures, it's stunning. Steve Bannon, Reince Priebus, James Comey, Michael Flynn, Sean Spicer, Dr. Tom Price, Sebastian Gorka, Rob Porter, that Rob Porter lookalike, the Mooch, Omarosa, Hope Hicks. The list goes on and on. And again, the president is said to be enjoying this latest installment of will he or won't he, perhaps even stretching it out. So as you might imagine, questions about the possible purge and the reported turmoil dominated today's White House briefing.
What was the president's reaction to all of these stories?
Has the president or the chief of staff made any kind of assurances to staffers today about what's to come?
Has the president spoken directly to either McMaster, Carson, Shulkin to tell them that their jobs are in fact safe?
Why is it that there is still a need for change inside the president's cabinet or among his circle of advisors?
Isn't it the president himself who's sort of creating this aura of, some use the word chaos, but simply put, turmoil or a potential upheaval within the West Wing and, frankly, across the administration?
Well, for the record, Sarah Sanders answered the first two questions with variations of no immediate personnel changes at this time. She did not answer Jeff Zeleny's question about why the need for changes at all. She answered the chaos question by saying in so many words, what chaos? But keep it honest, those last two questions deserve better because they speak directly to a pair of claims the president has made, including one he campaigned on.
We're going to make America great again. We're going to use our best people.
I'm going to get the best people.
We're going to deliver. We're going to get the best people in the world.
We don't want people that are B-level, C-level, D-level. We have to get our absolute best.
We're going to use our smartest and our best. We're not using political hacks anymore.
It's a sophisticated chess match, but I have the best people lined up.
You need people that are truly, truly capable. We have to get the best people.
The best people. So to Jeff Zeleny's question, why aren't they all still there? Sure, there's that private jet abuser who was fired and the alleged spousal abuser fired. And after all, what national security advisor hasn't lied about contacts with Russians and pleaded guilty and turned state's evidence? The best people. As for the president being the source of turmoil, chaos, upheaval, whatever you want to call it, the kind of stuff that might deter the best people from even considering a job at the White House, just a few days ago, the president said that is not a problem.
Believe me, everybody wants to work in the White House. They all want a piece of that Oval Office. They want a piece of the West Wing. Yeah, there'll be people. I'm not going to be specific, but there'll be people that change. They always change. Sometimes they want to go out and do something else, but they all want to be in the White House. So many people want to come in. I have a choice of anybody. I could take any position in the White House, and I'll have a choice of the 10 top people having to do with that position. Everybody wants to be there.
Like Omarosa. Keep it honest, though, even barring any new shakeup, the turnover in this administration, it's without modern precedent. According to a new study from the Brookings Institution, 43% of the president's staffers have quit, switched jobs, or have been fired. And that's more than double any modern presidency. The number could be growing, and being president is hard enough without the turnover, without the turmoil, without the day-to-day drama of who's in and who's out. I want to get perspective now from two longtime White House pros, Leon Panetta, who served as Chief of Staff, Defense Secretary, and Director of the CIA, and David Gergen, who has worked in both chaotic and calm administrations. Mr. Secretary, does it surprise you at all that here we are yet again having yet another conversation about yet more chaos in the White House?
Nothing surprises me anymore, unfortunately, because, it appears that this president likes to operate by chaos. And likes to keep staff constantly concerned about whether or not they're going to have a job. I'm not quite sure I understand that. I think stability is a much better course for the White House to take because you're dealing with an unstable world. If you have an unstable staff, it makes it that much tougher to deal with that kind of world.
You know, David, there's an old, I think it's a Dorothy Parker quote, those born to the storm find the calm very boring. I mean, you worked in the Nixon White House. Can you just explain what effect instability has on the functioning of the executive branch?
You just reminded me, Anderson, of a friend who went to see President Trump and asked him, how well are you navigating the storm? And the president turned to him and said, I am the storm.
Is that really true?
That's what a friend told me.
Wow.
I was like, whoa, it's single source, but nonetheless. Listen, I think that Leon is absolutely right. If there is calm at the center, if there is steadiness at the center, there's calm that radiates throughout the whole team. But when there's instability at the center and the president is the storm, that radiates as well. And it causes enormous anxiety. It keeps people are not focused on getting the job done in the same way. Morale goes down. It's very tough. So when John Kelly, the chief of staff, told us, apparently gathering the staff in his office this morning, we have no immediate personnel changes at this time. Immediate and at this time. Underscore those and what they may mean. I mean, why is that reassuring?
Secretary Panetta, I mean, just in terms of any possible staff changes, if the president is trying to hire advisors who are more closely aligned with his worldview, I mean, that is his prerogative. Isn't that what most presidents do, surround themselves with people who support their agenda?
Well, not necessarily. I always thought that the strongest presidents are willing to have people who come in who may not represent the same viewpoint. I think it's important for presidents not to be surrounded by a bunch of yes men. If you have people that only will say yes to the president, then I don't think the president's going to be well served. I think what the president should get, because most of these issues are tough to deal with, he needs to have different viewpoints. He needs to have different opinions about just exactly how to approach these issues. And he ought to be strong enough to be able to listen to those kinds of views, whether he agrees or disagrees with them. That's the way presidents should operate. That's obviously the way this president doesn't like to operate.
You know, David, there's this notion now that the president's more confident, that he now feels he understands the job of being president more than he did than when he first started, and that he's starting to rely more on his own instincts. If that's true, I would imagine we just expect the chaos to continue.
Oh, I think that's right. He's acting like, you know, the people who worked for him earlier were just training wheels. And he's now up and running himself, and he enjoys it more. He's, you know, reportedly by his aides, he's happier now than he was when he was surrounded by people who challenged him. But I think Leon's point is absolutely right. I would just reinforce it by saying, look, it's particularly important to have dissenting voices when you're going to depart from long-standing traditions in American foreign policy or in American domestic policy. Somebody ought to be there to say, help to understand the history behind it, why it was done, whether it's been successful or not, before you make sort of, you know, off-the-cuff kind of decisions about I'm going to do this and do that without regard to all the wisdom that may be stored up on people who worked in more traditional ways.
Yeah, and Secretary Panetta, this Wall Street Journal reporting that the president and General Kelly have, quote, settled on a truce, in their words. I wonder, I mean, when you were President Clinton's chief of staff, were you ever engaged in a serious enough battle with him that a truce had to be called or settled upon?
I never had that experience, because very frankly, if there's a truce or something that basically says, yeah, you can stick around for a while anyway, it undercuts your position. I'm not quite sure I understand how John Kelly is able to make it from day to day when he's got his head under a guillotine. And the same thing is true for H.R. McMaster. You really need to have a relationship of trust between the chief of staff and the president. And they ought to be able to trust each other, and they ought to be able to deal with each other. And if that falls apart, very frankly, it means that that relationship is not going to work.
Yeah, David, just the fact the president told advisors yesterday that Kelly was, quote, 100% safe, it does feel sometimes like we're witnessing the, you know, White House version of Survivor, just waiting for the next person to get you know, get voted off the island.
I absolutely, Anderson. And that's why I think, to paraphrase Macbeth, if it were done to be done, it was best done quickly. You know, he needs to, whatever, if he's going to clean house, he ought to do it quickly and reform and tell everybody, okay, from now on out, you're safe. We're going to go, this is our team for the next year. That would let things settle down. To have this, this is what Tillerson went through and what McMaster is now going through. Lots of leaks coming out of the Oval Office.
Is it possible he's drawing it out to sort of inflict maximum pain or indecision or get, you know, juice the news cycle in some way?
Anderson, trying to do psychoanalysis with him is just beyond me. I don't know. But he clearly, it's in his DNA. He likes the drama. He likes the reality show quality of it. And it's, I'm not sure anybody is telling him, Mr. President, it's doing so much damage to your standing and your standing in the world.
David Gergen, Secretary Panetta, thank you.
It's good to be with you.
Well, a lot more ahead tonight. The next breaking news in the Stormy Daniels story, the president's legal team has just filed a new motion. We've just gotten it. We're looking it over. We'll tell you what it says and why they've done this. Also, the word from Stormy Daniels' attorney that not one, not two, but six other women who've come forward with similar stories about the president, what that could mean. And later, searching for answers in the wreckage of the bridge that collapsed now has claimed six lives. The very latest tonight on 360. There's breaking news in the Stormy Daniels lawsuit against the president. The president's legal team has filed papers to get the case out of California state court and before a federal judge. Now, on top of that, there's new word from her attorney that her story may not be the only one.
We've been approached by six separate women with similar stories to my client. I want to stress that we have not vetted these stories to any great degree. However, the initial consultations, the initial information that we're receiving indicates that there are some striking similarities between their stories and that of my client, Ms. Clifford.
Can you say if any of these women have non-disclosure agreements?
Yes.
They do.
At least two of them.
So with that now out there, we should bring in our own legal advice. Mark Garagos is here, as well as Laura Coates. So Mark, first of all, this filing by Michael Cohen, can you just explain exactly what it means, why the president's team would want to move the case?
Well, there's usually two reasons. One, you either don't like the state court judge, which it could be in this case, or you want to get it out of the state court and into federal court, which is a common move by usually corporations or large-scale defendants. They feel like they get better justice for them in federal court. The irony here is that Trump obviously is the person who appoints federal judges, and he does not have any sway over state court judges. The interesting little twist to this, though, is the state court judge could do very little to enforce anything against the executive branch. So it may be a case of be careful what you wish for, because now the federal judge, which is what's called an Article III judge, will have the authority to order things against Donald Trump as an executive in the executive branch, whereas the state court judge would have had a lot more trouble enforcing any order she would have made.
Laura, does the move by Michael Cohen make sense to you, and do you think the request is going to be granted?
Well, they are qualified to do so because, remember, it has an amount in controversy limit. Essentially, in order to get to federal court, you got to show that people are from different states. That's called diversity. Also, that the amount that they're actually going to be seeking is worth a federal court Article III judge's time, and that's about $75,000. We already know, based on the filings of Michael Avenatti on behalf of Stormy Daniels, that $130,000 seems to be the base, and according to this NDA, if it, in fact, is held to be valid, you're talking about $1 million per breach of that claim, meaning about 20 millions. We're far above that particular amount in controversy. But it also makes sense because, well, ironically, they also moved last week to try to get it out of state court to a different judge who was not considered to be a front runner for a federal judgeship on behalf of Donald Trump. But it makes sense because they're going to have the benefit of a judge who does not have the same docket as a state court judge has. It's going to probably have more time. And also, federal courts are notorious for deciding deciding things on what's called the pleadings, the papers, without having to have all the hearings, without all the rigmarole. If there is a clear-cut case, they can decide it without having to be in a lot of hearings.
Mark, we haven't yet heard from Michael Avenatti. I think we're going to try to get him in this next hour. I think he's flying right now. But is this something you think he would agree to? Is there, or would there be a reason why he would want to keep it in the state court?
No, I think Michael will probably, once you remove it, the defendant has a right to remove it. Then it's up to the plaintiff or the opposite side, I should say, to come in and contest that. My guess is, my inclination would be, is that he would probably contest it, but he's going to wait and see who he draws in the central district here. In fact, we may already know that, and I'll take a look when you go to the next break. And when I say draw, know who the federal judge is. A lot of times that's how the decision is made.
Because whether they an attorney has experience with that particular judge or the reputation of that judge, what kind of a ruling they think they may get?
Correct. There's certain, unfortunately, one of the things in the law is that all judges don't decide things based truly on the law. There seems to be idiosyncrasies, you know, with a lot of judges. Certain judges lean to the defense. Certain judges lean towards compelling arbitration. So there's a lot of factors that go into whether or not you would contest this. And that, most of that will be a determination based on who the judge is.
So, Laura, now, you know, Michael Avenatti has claimed that there are six additional women who have come forward. He said he hasn't really fully vetted what their stories are. He says he believes two have NDAs. Is it possible that they could all use the same legal argument to try to get out of them, or would that all sort of ride on how similar the contracts were to the one that Stormy Daniels signed, if they're similar at all?
Well, really, it's the latter, because, of course, he said he hasn't vetted them. So what he's trying to do is buttress the claims of Stormy Daniels to the court of public opinion. Now, that can be very persuasive to people if you're following in the news, but not as much to a judge. Because if a judge is looking at the very central issue here, which is, number one, can Stormy Daniels, not the other six women who haven't been fully vetted and two of which may or may not have similar non-disclosure agreements, is there anything to allow Stormy Daniels to be able to speak? What it seems as though here, trying to do is, listen, if there is an overall theme here where a court is never going to try to enforce a contract that is against public policy, that includes whether or not there is a contract to do hushing of broken federal law, which would be campaign finance in this issue. If there is an overall theme where that is the effort and you have additional proof of an MO that basically says we've got more than one person where they've tried to silence, they all exceed the threshold of that $2,700 mark for campaign finance, and they were not disclosed. Well, they're trying to build all of that as a way of saying, if the court doesn't buy the non-signature argument as to why it's voided, if the court doesn't buy that Michael Cohen has voided it by speaking, and if the court doesn't buy that there's some other issue here, well, then it may be contrary to public policy by virtue of the strength in numbers. It's all of it an uphill battle, and that's why the judge is so important and why raising it to a federal court will raise the stakes of this litigation.
Mark, I mean, obviously, if six people have come forward, they would have to be vetted very carefully because, obviously, I mean, as you well know, as somebody who gets a lot of publicity with clients, Mark, anybody can come forward and make any claim whatsoever.
Well, you come to my office one day and see how many inquiries I got on an average day, half of whom are what we call in California 5150, which is a danger to themselves or others. So anybody can come out and claim anything, and you do have to vet it. The problem is that I don't think you're going to get to the point in federal court where any federal judge, at least in the central district here, is going to start letting you make this into a dog and pony show. And remember, most judges have an inclination to take something if there's an arbitration or an agreement for arbitration to compel arbitration. And the reason for that is it's one less thing on their docket, especially here in the central district where the judges are conceitedly overworked.
Yeah, Mark and Laura, I just got a statement from Michael Avenatti, and I want to read it. I'm just reading it as I've been handed it. Michael Avenatti, Stormy Daniels' attorney, says, "This is simply more of the same bullying tactics from the president and Mr. Cohen. They are now attempting to remove this case in order to increase their chances that the matter will ultimately be decided in private arbitration behind closed doors outside of public view and scrutiny. To put it simply, they want to hide the truth from the American people. We will oppose this effort at every turn." goes on to say, the fact that a sitting president is pursuing over $20 million in bogus damages against a private citizen who's only trying to tell the public what really happened is truly remarkable, likely unprecedented in our history. We're not going away. We will not be intimidated by these threats. Laura, what do you make of that?
Well, first of all, it's not actually bullying if you're able to avail yourself of the courts. What it comes down to is, honestly, Stormy Daniels, a.k.a. Tiffany Clifford, entered into a contract that was not favorable to her. They tried a variety of ways to say that it's void or voidable, and they don't want it to be enforced. A lot of things have been about that. But a court, if it is a valid contract, a court is not going to second-guess her own decision to do, though, to enter into that contract. And so what you're seeing here is, frankly, a litigant who is saying, I have every right to avail myself of arbitration because that was what was agreed to in the court. That was what was agreed to in the contract. And I don't need a court to second guess this because it's not for a court to figure out if either party had the benefit of the bargain. All that it takes is a meeting of the mind. So to suggest it's bullying to engage in civil litigation is actually more of a hyperbole than anything else. But his point is well taken because, of course, this is all betting on the notion of the court of public opinion in many ways to say that why is the president of the United States so averse to this particular person speaking? What is he trying to hide? Now, that innuendo is powerful persuasion in the court of public opinion, but I doubt that it actually persuades the court to say whether or not this was a good contract or one that you just don't like anymore.
Yeah. Well, Stormy Daniels will be
well, there's also,
in 6 minutes. Mark, go ahead.
I was just going to say there's also one other added thing, and this may be of some interest to you.